Aortic valve stenosis is a disease of the aortic valve, which is one of the two valves on the left side of the heart, that occurs when calcification deposits on the leaflets and restricts the ability of the leaflets to open. This can occur as a natural process of aging, the wear and tear on the valve over decades of life, or it can occur in the setting where there are only two leaflets of the aortic valve, something called bicuspid aortic valve disease. In any event, this results in the valve leaflets being restricted in their motion, and in order for the heart to pump blood through that valve, it has to generate extra pressure, and over time, this causes the heart eventually to fail. Gold standard for decades of dealing with aortic valve stenosis is surgical aortic valve replacement. And that involves open heart surgery, wherein the surgeon cuts out the old valve and sews in a new valve, either a mechanical valve or a bioprosthetic valve. In the last decade, technology has advanced to being able to replace the aortic valve with a catheter technique. And that is what is called transcatheter aortic valve replacement, or TAVR, T-A-V-R.
The recent clinical research and trials have shown that TAVR is non-inferior to surgery. That means that the morbidity and mortality associated with this procedure is now equivalent to standard surgical aortic valve replacement. There is a significant difference between the type of anesthesia we provided during surgical aortic valve replacement and the type of anesthesia the patient who receives TAVR has. In surgical aortic valve replacement, the patient needs to receive general anesthesia for the purpose of undergoing endotracheal intubation and mechanical ventilation and eventually being connected to the heart and lung machine in order to replace his valve. It can induce more stress on the patient's heart performance, but overall it's more difficult to tolerate for the patient in general. During TAVR, especially with the most recent approach we provide to the majority of our patients, approach known as minimalist, all we need is monitor conscious sedation, meaning the patient received only a minimal dose of sedation, remains awake throughout the entire procedure and is able to communicate with both his anesthesiologist and the doctor in charge for the procedure.
Obviously, when we're talking about a catheter delivery of the valve, it's less invasive. It does not require general anesthesia. It does not require going on the heart-lung machine. So the patients are awake during the procedure. There's no cutting or incision. Catheters are introduced after local anesthesia, and the valve is then delivered within the existing valve. There are currently two types of valves, a self-expanding valve and a balloon expandable valve. And in each case, that valve is then inserted within the existing valve, pushing the existing valve to the side. So after their one night stay in the hospital, patients are seen at 1 month and 1 year by the valve implanting team. This is mandated by Medicare. Patients are discharged on an antiplatelet drug, either aspirin or another antiplatelet drug. These valves do not require conventional oral anticoagulation, as do mechanical valves. After 1 year, patients then are returned to their referring cardiologist and undergo annual echocardiograms to look at the function of the new valve. In terms of durability of the valve, we now have 7 to 8 year data with these valves, and they seem to be as durable as a surgical bioprosthetic valve. Obviously, within time, all of these biological valves wear out, and an additional procedure may be required at some point in the future, but that may be 10 or 15 years from the time of implant.
The quality of life after aortic valve replacement, whether that's performed through surgery or TAVR, it's remarkable. We all know that patients who has severe aortic valve stenosis and require the replacement of his valve has a very elevated morbidity and mortality within 1 year of the onset of his symptoms. The main difference between the two procedures is that with surgery, the recovery time will be longer, but in either case, the recovery and the quality of life is remarkable.
One common approach to reduce leaking of the mitral valve is to apply a clip on the mitral valve that reduces the amount of leaking. We are also studying new catheter techniques for the tricuspid valve, which is on the right side of the heart. So there's very exciting work being done in multiple transcatheter technologies that are applicable to the heart.
The comprehensive assessment provided by the multidisciplinary team in our valve clinic, it's critical because it allows to establish the candidacy of the patient for either the surgical aortic valve replacement or the TAVR procedure. A patient is a candidate for TAVR only if he meets specific guidelines that allow us to define him as either prohibitive risk, high or intermediate risk for surgical aortic valve replacement. This type of assessment can only be performed when the cardiologist and the surgeon communicate and assess the patient together. At Johns Hopkins, we have an extensive experience with either surgical aortic valve replacement and TAVR. The structural heart program that performs the TAVR procedure has been active since 2011. And ever since then, we've been doing nearly 800 cases. We are one of the busiest programs on the East Coast. From a surgical standpoint, we have an experience that stems back for several decades and a very high success rate.